Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it wasn't consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And then he said, come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you're standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I've observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I've heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you, and this shall be a sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. But Moses said to God, if I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what's his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am that sent me to you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this my title for all generations. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm for this evening is Psalm 105, various verses. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon God's name. Make known the deeds of the Lord among the peoples. Sing to the Lord, sing praises, and speak of all God's marvelous works. Glory in God's holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Search for the strength of the Lord. Continually seek God's face. Remember the marvels God has done, the wonders and the judgments of God's mouth. O offspring of Abraham, God's servant, O children of Jacob, God's chosen ones. Israel came into Egypt, and Jacob became a sojourner in the land of Ham. The Lord made the people of Israel very fruitful, more numerous than their enemies, whose hearts God turned so that they hated God's people and dealt unjustly with the servants of God. O Lord, you sent Moses, your servant, and Aaron, your chosen one. Alleluia. Alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia. Gospel according to Matthew, the 16th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. From that time on, after Peter confessed that Jesus was the Messiah, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block. stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Then Jesus told his disciples, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in the kingdom. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Keeping with our theme, I'm kind of doing the continuous, so we're back in Exodus. So, I must turn aside and look at this great sight. We began our journey through the Old Testament with the Genesis story of creation, and we were reminded that as human beings, we're created with a calling to be fruitful and multiply, to fill the earth and subdue it, to have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and every living thing that moves upon the earth. Today, we hear the call of Moses and how he wrestled with God's call, feeling totally unqualified. After our reading, you can read on if you want, but he even asked God to send someone else in his place. What a time he would go. So much of this story is about telling Moses who he is and who God is. Perhaps after hundreds of years of slavery in Egypt, the Israelites forgot the promises given by God to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Wouldn't it be hard to believe a promise of freedom and land after generations and generations of slavery? This moment at the burning bush is a moment of introduction for Moses. It's a new beginning. We all need reintroductions, reminders of who we are and who God is. That's what we do at church each week. Remind ourselves of who we are and who God is. Now, a lot of commentators and preachers focus on the excuses Moses offers. I'm not a good talker. How will the people know I'm speaking for you? What name can I give them? I don't really want to go. Could you just send someone else? And of course, this is our first introduction to God's name for God's self. I am who I will be. Or I am who I am. It can be translated a number of ways. My preference is, I will be who I am. That is, God will faithfully be God for Moses. God will live up to that divine name. The God of your ancestors is who I am and who I will continue to be for you. The name is about relationship, not hierarchy. Moses often gets maligned for his resistance to God's call, but we have to give him this. He did turn aside to learn more about this unconsumed burning bush. One of my professors in seminary said about this passage, I wonder how long God waited for someone to notice. God does not call out to Moses until God saw that he turned aside to see. Now, what qualities was God looking for? God looking for a co-worker to save the Israelites. God seems to need human action to carry out his audacious plan. What does God need? Curiosity? Willing to take a risk? Let me turn aside and see this wonderful sight. Once upon a time, there was a young man attending college as a theater education major. He was kind of awkward. He wasn't really very flexible. But he was required by his theater degree to take a number of dance and movement classes. He performed in a couple of student choreographed dance concerts and realized he could add a dance minor to his diploma with more of these performances, including choreographing a solo piece and then an ensemble project. He turned aside to look at dance as part of who he might be. Then he turned aside to see what would it take to make dance his minor. All on his own, in the summer of his junior year, he created his own dance internship with a company in Houston, a bit far from his college in Ohio. In Houston, he met a guy named Bill, who was the artistic director of a small modern dance company, Dance Inlet, in Cleveland, Ohio. He took the initiative to work for Bill over Christmas break his senior year and became a trainee with Inlet Dance Theater immediately after graduation. Did his parents worry about his future? Were they concerned that he would be working at Starbucks the rest of his life to support himself as a starving artist? Yeah, I'll admit it, sometimes we did. His journey began 20 years ago. He loved his work, encouraging other young artists, especially other young men, to embrace their creative side. Turning aside from the norm made all the difference. By turning aside, he discovered his calling was not necessarily theater, but he was to pour himself into this company that uses dance to further people. That's their motto. Here is where he found his true creative identity. Joshua married a wonderful woman who was also in Houston all those years ago and became a trainee the same year he did. Perfect match. It just took him 7 years to figure it out. It's all right. It's good. It has been a long time since I have worried about that young man. And now, after officially retiring from Inlet in 2020 and supporting his growing family the past 3 years by delivering packages for Amazon, he turned aside to seek new possibilities. He applied for grad school. His aim to teach college dance, that did not pan out, but it seems God worked through the dance company director, Bill, to find a way to stay connected with dance and the arts and support his family. The company applied for and received a grant to create a position within Dance Inlet, which Josh had already been doing kind of on a per diem basis, leading class, working with the trainees, helping with coordinating gigs, scheduling and administration, and choreography, and the like. They haven't figured out a title for him yet, but I think maybe apprentice to the artistic director would be suitable. He turned aside from that college teaching model to realize an apprenticeship model and 20 years of dance experience could fulfill and grow his creative identity. We and he feel he is right where he needs to be. And it all started with being open to turn aside, to see and create opportunity. Do any of us know what our life would be like if we chose to ignore the call to turn aside and see where God might be leading us? Where do we see God calling us today? Into whose pain and suffering and oppression are we called to bring freedom, like Moses? If we expect that following the call of Jesus means we can ignore the burning issues of injustice, poverty, loneliness, isolation, addiction, you name it, then maybe we don't really understand Jesus and his call to his disciples. Following Jesus requires cross-bearing, as our gospel lesson tells us. We could argue, as Moses did, that we are unprepared, untrained, too unequipped for God to use us, and would rather God just send somebody else. God did not let Moses get away with that, and I doubt we can get away with it either. Saying, "Here I am, Lord," is not necessarily the beginning of a walk in the park, but it is the beginning of discovering holy ground. Because of Jesus, all ground is holy. He turned aside from his deity and took the path to the cross so that we can experience holiness in all places and in all things. Moses took off his shoes for that holy ground. Taking off one's shoes makes running away difficult. I picture Moses standing on the hot sand, wondering if he could bolt before God asked him to do something he did not want to do. But his shoes were not on his feet, as so he stood there on holy ground. He stayed and said, "Here I am, send me." He turned aside and discovered God calling. Will we turn aside and discover our true identity in the life death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus, where do we begin? Perhaps with the simple response, "Here I am, Lord. I'm listening. Send